Good evening. The time is now 6:32 p.m. It is Monday, October the 19th, 2020. This is a regularly scheduled meeting of the Board of Trustees of Goose Creek Consolidated Independent School District. I'm asking our Assistant Secretary, Mr. Clem, if you would please declare a quorum.
We do have a quorum.
And was this meeting properly posted?
Yes, ma'am, it was.
Excellent. At this time, I would move to agenda item number two, opening exercises, which I believe Ms. Susan Jackson, are you in charge for Austin Elementary also?
So good evening, Madam President, Dr. Brown, board members. Tonight's opening exercises will be presented by the students at Stephen F. Austin Elementary. We'll begin opening ceremony with a prayer led by Ben Hawkins.
Let us pray. Dearly Father, we're grateful for this evening. We're grateful for the joy that thou has given us. And we're grateful for thy Son, Jesus Christ. We pray this evening as we come together for this board meeting that we'll have thy Spirit here with us to help us make wise and good decisions on behalf of the district and staff and students of Goose Creek CISD. We love thee and praise thee in all that we do. We pray for these things in the name of thy Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Please be seated.
Okay, the following students will be, The Pledge of Allegiance will be led by Brandy Henriksen, and the Texas Pledge will be led by Ainsley Finwalking.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Honor the Texas flag, I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state, under God, one indivisible.
Okay, the following students will be performing Do the Good You Know with us tonight virtually are Ainsley Benoit, Davila Carmona, Esther Sendejas, Malaya Cisneros, Lena Garza, Jaylee Garzovia, Tristan Grant, Brady Henriksen, Layla Martinez, Mackenzie Reynolds, and Temperance Yogan.
You can save the world till alone.
donation for the evening is the donation of ExxonMobil. And with us tonight is Connie Tolman.
Actually, it's your talk. Helping me is going to be Lisa Steele. Good evening, Madam President, Dr. O'Brien, and members of the board. I would like to start off by recognizing one of our giants in Goose Creek CISD, Ms. Lisa Steele, our HR coordinator. Without her efforts and diligence, we would not be here tonight to recognize these outstanding individuals. Ms. Steele and former employee Lindsay Marek were co-authors of a TEA grant. The TEA grant awarded the Goose Creek Human Resources and the CTE department the Grow Your Own Cycle 3 grant in the amount of $109,000 to promote the quality and diversity of teachers in our district. The CTE department would like to recognize the following education and training teachers who will receive a $5,000 stipend to be paid over the next 2 years. Each campus was also awarded a $3,000 in grant to help fund purchase classroom equipment supplies that will help these teachers grow our students into future Goose Creek teachers. One of our teachers that's present here tonight is Ms. Deborah Turner. Ms. Turner, would you please come up here? And she's assigned to Goose Creek Memorial. The Human Resources Department would like to recognize the following para educators who will receive $12,000 over the next 2 years to earn a bachelor's degree and certification with the University of Houston at Clear Lake to become future teachers with Goose Creek CISD. First, we have Danielle Ramirez. Then we have Elizabeth Reese from San Jacinto. Joycelyn Garcia from Horace Mann. And do we have Malika King? She's not able to be here with us. Malika King is at Days of Aura in Malika. Thank you.
So at this time, I would like to ask that Dr. O'Brien and Madam Jessica Woods, President, please come up to present Technology Management Systems Resolution presented to Matt Webb and the TMS team.
We will come down stage for the picture, but I also wanted to go ahead and read a portion thereof. Whereas through the work of Matt Flood, and thanks to Houston Mayor Sylvester Turner, Region 4, and the Texas Education Agency, Goose Creek CISD received 16,000 iPads, for which half the cost, more than $3 million, was funded by the statewide initiative Operation Connectivity, helping GCCISD in its efforts towards reaching the goal of placing a device in the hands of all students. The technology department, under the direction of Matt Flood, Chief Technology Officer Steve Kester, Director of Educational Technology, and Kevin Billings, Director of Technology, rose to the challenges presented by the COVID-19 statewide, nationwide pandemic beginning in March 2020, training all teachers to proficiently use platforms such as Seesaw and Google Classroom. Therefore, be it resolved that we, the Board of Trustees of the Goose Creek CISD, do hereby commend the Goose Creek CISD Technology Department for its enormous effort and accomplishments and supporting the district's mission of developing the whole child and proving that here we grow giants. Mr. Flood, if you and your team will come on down for a picture with the president, myself, and following that, I'd like to bring back up to for a photo op Ms. Connie Tilton from ExxonMobil. As noted further down in the agenda, the donations from ExxonMobil this year exceeded years in the past, including money for technology and for PPE for COVID-19. Their annual Partners in Education donation, and then they called again and said, hey, we have hand sanitizers, and we donate pallets of hand sanitizers. So hats off to ExxonMobil and the partnership that they have with Goose Creek. We're very, very grateful. Ms. Tilton, if you will also join us down here in this moment, Darrell. Thank you.
The same from our all group and our new hires. And the last slide is our auxiliary staff, where you can see that we're relatively the same from our all group in our entire school.
Good evening. We want to start, we want to start by sharing with you some retention data to start this section. As you all know, that what piece of our strategic plan is to recruit and retain quality teaching staff and human capital for our organization. And so what we did is we looked at our 2018, 19, and 20 data to give you all some a viewpoint of how we're doing as it relates to retention. You'll see that in 2018 we had 84% retained. In 2019 we made gains. We went to 85%. You'll see a jump between 2019 and 2020 of 3 percentage points. As you all know, COVID-19 has impacted organizations in a variety of ways. And whereas we were making gains, and we are making gains in those areas, a portion of that, it has to be contributed to COVID-19, as when you have these types of, this type of uncertainty, people sit still, they don't move around. As some of y'all may recall, 2010, 2011, there was not a lot of motion during that time because of the uncertainty within the organization and across the state. And the same thing is happening with COVID-19. When these types of things happen, people sit still, and I think you'll see that in the numbers come up. So if we move forward with our slides, I want to share with you new hires by licensure standards, probationary, gives you an idea of a number of teachers that we hired. As you can see, we hired 206. Finally caught up, and now they're starting to pull away. A large percentage, I think
traditional college grounds. And so I'd like to share that with you also that you have that in mind as well, that most of our talent are coming through alternative certification programs.
And this is a couple of years old, that data, but it was, I believe it was 2 years ago. The number one university that certified brand new first-time teachers in the state was Texas State University, San Marcos. They certified a little over 600 new educators. The same year, the number one certifier was Texas Teachers of Tomorrow, or however their name is at this point, and they certified over 6,000 new teachers. So it's the alternative certification almost isn't alternative anymore. It almost is the primary path. And then my piece, I'm talking about looking at our tenure and experience in the district. This first graph, this is just all the employees in the district by their district tenures, or just how long our employees have stuck with us. What we are seeing is that our employees are kind of aging up with us a little. We had our 0 year be much larger than it had been in the past, so it's nice to see that number dropping a little, our other middle range growing as our people are staying with us a little longer. We can also see them very similar with our teachers, where we're really seeing some larger chunks of our teachers have been with us for 6 to 10 years, 11 to 15 years. Looking longitudinally, this is also, as we move into our equity plan process, this data, we are hopeful is going to be very useful in that, and it's also going to be we've already kind of started the right kind of trends as we move forward. Looking at, this is just the longitudinal demographics of all employees by their job groups. If you look specifically at our teachers, you can see that we have made some great gains in increasing our minority representation amongst our teachers. We've seen a large increase in the number of Black teachers and the number of Hispanic teachers over the last 4 years. In looking at our tenure in the district longitudinally, at the top is all employees, the bottom is teachers. And this is where you can see that the number of teachers at BU who have been in the district for the less amount of time has decreased, while the ones who have been with us longer has increased as our people are sitting with us and maturing up with the organization. And looking at our new hires, this is where you can see, mainly spoke looking at our teachers, where we have made some great strides in increasing our hiring practices in focusing on trying to have up our teaching population near our student population, which is really one of our big goals. So we've really seen some great strides there over the last few years. And then again, this is just looking longitudinally at our quality for new hires. As you can see, we're on a very good downward trend with our hiring fewer zero-year teachers. That shot up this year due to COVID and everything else. Again, that's the end of our presentation of data. Do you have any questions, any comments?
Can we get that in a PowerPoint?
Yes.
Thank you. All the questions that we have.
Yeah,
thank you very much for your report.
Thanks to our HR team. Our next report this evening is our COVID-19 update. Ms. Stephanie Meyer.
Our total cases we've had since the 28th of September, and that's looking at a fully started face-to-face on site, is 65. So we have 29 individuals that are student and staff that have recovered from the virus. Since our last meeting, a couple of events we've had throughout the district is we have the COVID task force that was implemented, where we have several individuals from our groups throughout the district that meet on a weekly basis, and we go over different concerns and issues that we have on the campus, making sure we're addressing our safety protocols and guidelines. We also have campus-wide trainings that took place when school started, and then we have our COVID campus coordinators that are assigned to each campus to assist with coordination and be the first point of contact for any individual that's not feeling well and the next step in the process. And then we also have our back-to-school guide that provides guidance on procedures. Our on-site requirements, these are posted throughout all of our locations for all of our employees, and we have sent out this information to each employee. If you're sick, do not come to work. We require all employees to wear a mask, social distance of at least 6 feet, limit or suspend visitors at the campus or departments, similar to our testing schedule that we have, and we're doing testing at the facilities. And we have mandatory requirements for visitors if allowed. Those requirements are actually on the doors of all campuses. Our guidelines for the campuses for each location is that we do not allow any eating in our break rooms. We limit celebrations and large group gatherings. We do a grab and go setup. If we have any celebrations at the campuses where they can grab and go to their rooms or to another area. We also have all the doors inside the facility should remain open to keep airflow going. Our visitors are seen by appointment only in open areas, not in the offices. And then additionally, screening tools are at each campus or location have been implemented for temperature checks and other screening questions. The notification for our COVID for any employee who is positive for COVID, has been exposed to anybody who has COVID or has a family member in the household who is positive or has been to symptoms of COVID, will do the following. And so the employee's first point of contact is their COVID coordinator at the campus of their need to be off work or the situation that's going on, whether they're not feeling well or if there's somebody in the household. The COVID coordinator contacts the benefits department, and then employees who are eligible to work from home. And then we, for those who are not able to work from home, then we do have a COVID AED. And then each employee gives instructions on testing, whether they need to test or if they're exposed, if they have to test after a certain time period and in quarantine time period. Our return to work process for all of our employees.
Maybe not. Okay. So our return to work process for our employees to be released is we are looking at the CDC guidelines. So CDC guidelines actually say that an employee can be released after a positive test result once they have 10 days of isolation, symptoms are improving, and they're 24 hours fever free. If for any individual that has an exposure, we do actually have them quarantined for 5 days and they have to test the 6th day. For any employee that has an exposure in the household, they are quarantined for 14 days, and then they have to receive a negative test result on the 15th day before being released to return back to work. Our testing facilities that we have available is we have a partnership with Methodist Hospital that provides PCR testing. We get results within 24 hours. This is free to all of our employees. We also have the Goose Creek Employee Wellness Clinic that does rapid test results in 20 minutes. This is free to all of our employees. We have Patient CR, we have a partnership with them. We get rapid results within 1 hour. There's no charge, but it is charged to the insurance at this location. And then we also have next level urgent care, rapid test results within 20 minutes. It's charged to the insurance. Depending on the coverage that the employee may have, they may have a copay. We also have our ADA accommodations at the campus level. This is for our employees who have underlying health conditions and they're at a higher risk for getting COVID. We have about 80 teachers that apply for some type of accommodation. 40 teachers were approved for an accommodation. The accommodations include conducting virtual instruction from a remote location on site, while paraprofessionals or another staff member supervise students in the classroom. We also have providing additional classroom support to assist students who may need one-on-one attention to kind of eliminate the exposure to the teacher. And then we provide additional PPE equipment such as desk shields for teachers and face shields. Our COVID numbers as of July 1st, we have quarantined 440 employees for symptoms, exposures, or confirmed positive cases. Out of that number, 390 have returned to work, 86 were positive cases, 65 were recovered cases, 113 employees were paid by the COVID pay leave, and 259 employees worked from home. The dashboard numbers that reflected on the first slide were as of the first day of instruction for face-to-face instruction from September the 28th. Question?
Yes, I have a question. Would an employee contact if they have any concerns or questions in regards to some of the protocols, whether they're following or they feel comfortable just to maybe put their minds at ease? Because I'm sure everybody has gotten phone calls about, you know, things they may not feel comfortable with, or, you know, I know that last meeting we talked to Dr. Ryan about some concerns, and those things were, you know, he did a good job of expressing those to some of our leadership. But if an employee has a concern, who would they contact?
So they would contact the benefits department.
Benefits? Is anybody specific or?
Me, benefits coordinator.
Okay.
So Stephanie Myers.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Excuse me. I hear everything from the employee aspect. Do we have anything for the key itself? For us, methods we would continue to do with the in-class learning kids, or we just open the wear a mask, or what? Do we have anything? Are you open to that part also?
So for all of our students at the campus, we have the, for all of our locations, we have the shields. We'll try to keep down the numbers low in the classroom, but of course, the second 6 weeks we've had more kids that have stepped involved in the fact that they said it's not. So with that being said, they're still trying to facilitate other areas of the campus to keep the kids spread out. But we do have a day shield that the desk shield can pull it students have to wear their masks inside the classroom. So do the employees, they sanitize their hands on a regular basis. And then with all of our employees and our students,
now, they can ask as they walk around in the halls and everything else?
Yes. So masks are required at all facilities while in the hallways and in the classroom. Now, they do give them every, maybe twice a day or periodically in the classroom, they will give them mask breaks, but they're behind the desk shield.
Okay. Now, my last question. How many cases have we had students, like we show with employees? But Mr. Flood, can you pull up the current dashboard?
Are we tracking those who are not
face-to-face on campus at all? Like the students who are staying at home virtual, is they're not included in any of this?
They're not included on the actual dashboard, but we do give the information that they're tested positive. And we do track that in case they are more than switching to face-to-face for the next issue.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Meyer.
Thank you.
Our next presentation will be on bilingual ESL program evaluation, dual language program implementation by Dr. Pilar Moreno Lucio.
Many schools in our district did not test last year because of COVID.
they were not able to complete the assessment. So when you have here is 2019 data, the target is 36%, which means that campuses need to get to a 36% of campus composite growth in order to meet the standard. So what you see there, and highlighted for you in gray, are schools that we are right now targeting to make sure they are accelerating and supporting English language learners. The next one is a piece of information that I think is good news for Goose Creek because it shows historically the number of exits that we have had in our program since 2016. And if you look at 2018, you see a big drop, right, in the data. And the reason is because EA at that year was the year that they decided to test our English language learners with the online test for listening and speaking. We were not as prepared as we would have liked to, but that happened across the entire state of Texas. So the numbers dropped that year. We didn't see that this year we have been able to pick up the pace that we had in 2017. We having right now the a big amount of exits this year, and it has contributed to the fact that TA allow us to test the students with the last links test. That is a test that the students have been preparing more for during the last 2 months and throughout the year. So we know we have been emphasizing the need for listening and speaking in the classrooms. You know, we have been kind of on a mission to make that happen. And those campuses, like we have Baytown, for example, in the Baytown Junior School in the Jupiter pattern, we have seen great increase in the exits because they have, you know, been on a mission ensuring that the students were monitoring their own voice for listening and speaking. Okay. The next one that we need to give an account of, you know, the professional development that we provide for our teachers, our aides, and our administrators, and also our parents, because we train the entire community. So this is kind of a snapshot for you to see what contributes to the growth over time of the data that you see, especially for content. And that's kind of the very summarized report of the annual report that I have for you. Dr. White is going to give you an account of the waivers and exemptions as a consequence of teachers who may be teaching in the bilingual or ESL program, but they are not certified.
Yes. And so looking here, this is just our current teacher to student ratios at each grade level. So if all of our teachers and students are perfectly distributed, of course with this example, that would be the case, but this is how our ratios could be. The reason we have this here is it shows that while the availability of other teachers can be an issue, we do have a very large number in our district that we are able to service our students with possibly adjusting our program model. You know, over the last 5 years, you can see just the number of waivers that we have done. The first column is the number of students for whom we apply for an exception. The next column is the number of classrooms. So what the difference there is if one teacher teaches two sections, three sections, four sections, each one of those sections has a classroom that we're having to get an exemption. Third column is the number of teachers who we have to apply for exception for each year. And then the last column is looking at our ESL exceptions for the ESL waivers for the same year. The thing that we see here that is good but not good enough is we are making progress in having less waivers and less teachers, but it's not the step that we want. Part of the issue there that comes in with the certification requirements. In a transitional program like we use, all of the core content area subjects must be taught by teachers and made by the university. In a dual language approach, it's driven by the language of instruction. So if a class is taught in English, it can be taught by ESL certified teachers. If it's taught in Spanish, it can be taught by English certified teachers. It gives a little more flexibility to our campuses. I'll just give a quick example. This is just three kids at one of our campuses. Under the transitional program, student A gets all four core from Ms. Garcia. Ms. Garcia is bilingual certified. This student is perfectly compliant. There's no need for us to apply for a waiver. student needs, even as far as PEP or ELA and social studies, but then to have Mrs. Smith for math and science, Mrs. Smith is ESL certified. Under the transitional model, we are not complying with the required student body rule. Student sees Susan Escarcia for ELA and social studies, and then gets math and science from Ms. Jones, who is a fully certified core subjects teacher, but does not have ESL or bilingual certification. In that case, we're not complying with the rule of the ELA. With a dual language approach, the rules change. The student A, who receives everything from Ms. Garcia, is still completely okay. We are compliant. Student B, who is receiving ELA and social studies from Ms. Garcia, and then receiving math and science from Mrs. Smith, ESL certified teacher, is also compliant with no waiver needed. This right here is one of the issues we have at Penn State that requires to be waivers, is that we have several teachers, and so Penn State have teachers who are ESL certified instructing students in English in those subjects, but because of our current program model, it doesn't count. When looking at the dual language versus transitional model approach, I will never say there will never be an additional teacher needed or something. However, the transitional model we currently do is also a staff-heavy program. So between the two, I've actually seen them balancing out or even possibly helping us out a little bit. Just as this is an example that in the transitional model, you would start with 22 LEP students in kinder, but as they progress up in first, second, third, fourth, on into fifth grade, the number of students who are still left is going to reduce as they get exited. They will go into the regular ed classroom, meaning you have the need for an additional regular ed teacher. In a dual language program, even when the teacher no longer considers that, they still remain in the program in the classroom and continue on, which negates that need for additional teachers. We actually handle things much better for staff.
Okay, so according to Thomas and Collier, these are some of the most prestigious researchers in the United States and in the world when it comes to dual language or bilingual programs. You see the choice is very clear. When it comes to the long-term academic achievement, the dual two-way language program are the most successful. Okay? That's the program that right now we are piloting at Harvard and Harlem in kinder and first grade. We started last year in kinder, and those students move up to first grade. So right now we have two classrooms at each of the schools piloting the dual two-way program. What I have to say, as per the data that we have collected, because we couldn't finish the year, right, last year, but we knew that at the middle of the year last year, our students in the program, it was a pilot of 88 students. They were reading at or above grade level at the middle of the year when we did our student-led conferences with parents. So that was pretty impressive. What we want to suggest or propose is to continue with dual two-way all the way in these two schools to fifth grade, because of the model, how successful it is, but also allow us to expand to one of the schools, Alabama Elementary, to have one at each feeder pattern, one dual two-way program. Then we would like to see the one-way dual language program in all of the elementary schools. The difference between the one-way and the two-way is basically the composition of the students in the classroom. Two-way means that there are English speakers and Spanish speakers in the same classroom learning Spanish content and English content every other day. Okay? The one-way is called one-way because you only have one group of students. That would be our English language learners. And it would be the same, but it's one group of students learning English and Spanish in a 50-50 setting, meaning 50-50% setting, learning English and Spanish in alternative days. The program that we have right now is the yellow one. As you can see, it's the blue actually. It's a transitional model that, as you can see in the data, we can do well at the beginning of the program, and then over time, what happens is what you saw in the secondary schools, you saw red in the third class data. That's what we see at the end, in the long-term achievement of our ELs with those type of programs. So, the goal of dual language is basically to develop biliteracy. Biliteracy, which means that you develop both languages, English and Spanish, and that's what's happening right now at Carver and Carver in kinder and first grade. Those students are learning, you know, to speak, to read, to write in both languages concurrently since kinder. Okay? And then the transition to bilingual program, the one we have right now, the goal is just literacy in one language, English literacy. Okay? Next one. So what we did last year, we have been preparing for this for a long time now. It's not something that we just woke up today and said, let's go to the board and present to them, right? It has been 3-4 years we have been preparing. And we haven't done it earlier because we have been taking our time because we wanted to do it right. And we piloted it in a small because we wanted to make it quality and successful as well. But we went around the district in the area and for a while and I took a few principals and we went around and we looked at the table report and for the data show we are blue, we're the blue on the left. When you compare our early exit transitional bilingual program to the dual two-way program that is being implemented in the neighboring districts. So the data is pretty telling about you know, how we are doing compared to how we are doing. So we look at the data for reading, math, writing, and science, and those are at the approaches level. You see that? Now when you look at the master level, the contrast is much more sharp. The master's level. So we know the students in the dual programs, whether it is one way or two way, are performing at higher levels than the students in the transitional bilingual early exit. Because it's called transitional early exit, doesn't mean that they exit early. That's very important to understand. So the proposal, like I said, it will lead to continue with a two-way dual, and you see two different types of speakers, and those are actually our students at Harlem, right? Holding hands, because that's what they are. They're bilingual pairs. They build upon each other, you know, the English speaker, then they talk to Ryan, builds upon me, my Spanish class, but then I build upon him in his English class, right? And we're working on that, right? So that's how the dual program works, right? And then that's the one we would like to see implemented at another field pattern because of the success that we have seen. And continue to phase in the program grade level by grade level, doing it with quality, taking the time to build curriculum, you know, because it's a high maintenance program. You have to build curriculum, you have to prepare the teachers. It's teachers are engaged in very, very intensive planning. And the teachers really spoke. And their feedback was that every exit transition program is night, dual program is day. The way of teaching is completely different, but the most important thing is how much the students achieve academically, how quick they learn, because this pure language is very interactive in instruction, where the students have to be speaking, doing, writing, creating all the time, right? And that's what we see. And the other part would be the one way that it would be, we would like to start implementing the program in the rest of the schools to bring the equity that our ELLs need, you know, through the curriculum that we are building, and start bringing to first all the schools and then bring a grade level at a time. We are a year ahead at Harvard and, I call them Harvard. It's my Harvard project now. So they're a year ahead. The advantage of having them going ahead is to allow us to build that curriculum for the rest of the schools, right? Parents also spoke, right? They came to the student-led conferences hosted at Harvard and Harlem. The students brought their portfolios with the reading, writing, math data. And the students were able to speak in both languages, well, from the parent in both languages, and letting them know how much they have learned so far. The parents, we gave them a survey and we asked them, what have you noticed about your students, about your children at home? You know, how are you supporting them? So, and how satisfied are you with the program? From a scale of 1 to 5, pretty much an sample of 50 parents who returned the surveys, they were highly satisfied with 4 of 5, as you can see. And that's pretty much. We have more things, but we don't have time. So if you have any questions, let us know.
I have a question.
Yes.
First I want to commend you on the dual language program. I know I spoke to you outside about Carolina, but I have a, heard very great things about this program. I'm very excited about you adding it to a third theater pattern. I know for the dual language program, for the two-way, the children have to be tested and qualified. My question is actually about the one-way program that you want to implement in children entry. Is there also going to be an exam for that, or is that going to become the norm? And just to clarify, they're going to be taking classes in both languages to reinforce.
Correct. So the model we have now at both schools at Harvard and Harris is that I'm a Spanish teacher on Monday, and everybody comes to me on Monday for Spanish, but then on Tuesday my group goes to him to do it in English. So they are alternating language of the day. Okay. And we will do the same with the one way. With the one way, we are still looking at the language allocation time because we want to put a committee together. And we want to do kind of the same model, allow those students to have 50% of instruction, either Monday English, Tuesday Spanish, so that the bilingual teacher doesn't have to change languages on a given day. So she will do, she will do language.
So as children come into our program, say a kid comes in fifth grade, I know it's going to take years to implement these. Suppose a kid comes in fourth grade, will they go into this program if that's going to be the norm? After their year in the neural center, whatever they do, they'll go into this program.
That's what we would like to have. We feel that at any given time, like if a child comes from Mexico and comes to Alamo, we feel that we will be able to be immersed in English and Spanish, for fourth grade. He may need a little bit of support and acceleration, and we have to look at how that will look like. But I would say, yes, we're doing that in kinder with the students who don't have knowledge of Spanish as a second language, and they're able to be immersed and be successful. We feel the same can be for the adults at upper in other grades.
And I think it's really important, especially as they start the kids. Start moving up, and as this program grows with years and you have older kids, I think one of the and it's not like this anymore, but there's still a little bit of that. Sometimes the idea is that because a child doesn't know English doesn't mean they don't have the ability to know what terms are. So for example, biology, photosynthesis, just because you don't know what it's called in English doesn't mean you don't understand what the concept of photosynthesis is. And I see this as a program, as it progresses through the years, as a great way to be able to implement and solve that kind of issue within our bilingual ESL program. So I think it's a great idea. Thank you.
And we are implementing research-based practices. One of them is cross-linguistic connections that really, if you're a bilingual teacher, you understand how to help or assist the students to make connections between different languages. So that's an approach we are implementing and training our teachers on. So that they develop more meta linguistic awareness on the students, both English speakers and speakers. And what you see now at this time of the year is that the students are able to say, look, in Spanish we capitalize the first word of the title of the book, but in English it's all of them. So they start making this, they start noticing and speaking about those differences and similarities about the languages, which I think is very powerful. But all of that comes with training.
Thank you.
themselves as learners in the process with their children.
Okay.
So we do that as well.
Okay.
Yes, but the whole point is that at home, the child will be with that community of yeah. language learners, and we and the parents are learning as well.
Right.
Basically, one of the worries is that, for why I would be the English speaking parent, I said, I don't want to send any homework in Spanish, we don't know anything. I would tell them not to worry about that, not to worry about homework, because first, research says homework is not as important as much as what it happens during the school day, and that's what we try to tell the parents, but also we provide them, the license as a way for them to put themselves in the shoes of the kids.
Okay.
And develop a certain language as well.
Yeah.
That is one of the great pieces that right now our students go through our transitional level program. They don't, they may be bilingual, they're not bilingual. We don't teach literacy in Spanish right now. We use Spanish as a tool to teach English. The students who do a language program will actually be literate in English on that. And that's such a powerful tool that I wish I had.
That's right. And we see the students, they build more empathy. Part of the language learning is that it builds empathy. So you can see, students, Dr. Wadia, right?
Mm-hmm.
When they are being having a class, the Spanish teacher, they lean more on Pilar, the Spanish speaker. But when I am in the English teacher, what happens? He's my best friend, right?
Right.
So we think that empathy and that collaboration among the students and how they need each other. So that's another feature of that we really need to bring in our students as well. How do we more empathetic to the students and how the others can help me learn as well.
Mm-hmm.
It's all the benefits. We have seen lots of benefits in the program. And the most important thing is that we see in the way in how much the students are growing and learning. And like I said, last year we were cut short because of COVID. But what I can tell you is that the teachers who were doing the dual-to-way program, when COVID hit us, they were like nothing happened with the school teachers. Because they were already implementing tools, they were implementing system. Because it was part of their strong communication that they had to have with both communities of parents and speakers in the classroom. So that was another another plus of implementation.
Thank you.
So I just have a question for you. Why are we going so slow? Is it a staffing issue or? Okay, don't shut me down. That's only my concern, and I say that because I tried to sneak my children into the bilingual kindergarten class 15 some odd years ago, and I've been kind of nudging since then. We have two schools that do dual two-way. Why do we have 28 schools? What's the process to get this moving faster? I saw the slide where you have dates for the dual two-way to be expanded, grade level wise. What holds us back from going full throttle?
Because the thing that we need to do with quality is it takes a lot of curriculum writing. It depends on the staffing that you have. Like right now, we have three specialists in the bilingual program that are serving 25 elementary schools on top of building the curriculum, right?
So, does it take a specially certified teacher, though?
Yes, and actually, according to the certification, it takes a bilingual teacher to do the Spanish part, and an English certified teacher. In the area of the certification, you will have more flexibility because you can use either two bilingual teachers, or one bilingual and one ESL.
A big part of it is that we did not want to do a walk in and go, oh, hey, you're the language teacher. Have fun.
That's been done before.
I worked in a previous district that switched from a bilingual to dual language, and I was kind of out of it. It's very hard on teachers because they had to figure out this is a passion for our lives. We've been working on it. This is one of the first conversations we had when she got hired, was we need to switch to dual language. We've been trying to do it ever since.
Ever since. Way before Karen Thomas was a hopper.
So we wanted to make sure that it was done correctly and that we gave our teachers welcome you. So it is a little bit of a slow approach, but the kindergarten teachers are going to start with the one way, we'll cross, we're going to have 2 years worth of us actually doing dual language in the street to fall back on and to help them. So we'll have our two pilot campuses as kind of our game kids, our test, to help us with all the other campuses to make sure it goes well. Because we want this to be successful, we want this to be the new norm, I guess, for New Street forever, not just the flash.
I just feel like it's a long time overdue.
I'm going to be.
So yeah, I'm ready for you to start all campuses like tomorrow, next fall, as soon as you can.
And this summer, we started doing already training, dual training already in May for PPK first. In case this was going to be a group one, we wanted to be bigger because of all the original talents that we had, we decided to stop because teachers have to do and we'll call it here. We wanted to do it well. We knew we were going to implement PPK this year, so it was not going to be successful, right? So we wanted to slow down this year because of everything that was happening, but certainly we would come back stronger by implementing PPK first at once, because we have the curriculum now ready for that. And we have been already putting the seed in our PPK first bilingual teachers in the academy. We did a three-day academy, and we brought Elephant Puri, we trained them on PPK reading strategies already, preparing them, because it takes like a big, you know, a big effort to turn the wheel and the mindset of how we are teaching the early exit versus you're a bilingual teacher. You're going to have to use your two languages, and this is the structural way that we do in order to promote the academic achievement that we really need. And it's a mindset also of time, you know.
And you know, to hire more teachers, like a
bilingual. Thank you. And please forward that PowerPoint presentation to us.
That concludes our superintendent reports on the agenda for the evening. We move to item 7, action items. Consideration of consent agenda. Dr. Bryan?
Yes, before item 7A, consideration of consent. Number 1, donation to Exxon Mobil, both for the technology and PPE COVID-19, their partner in education and hand sanitizers previously mentioned. Number 2, donation from Academy Sports and Outdoors. Number 3, adoption of resolution regarding extracurricular status of 4-H members in Chambers County, consideration of adjunct faculty agreement. Number 4, grow your own grant. Number 5, Academy localized policy manual, update 115. Number 6, competitive seal proposal to CISD. Evaluation rankings and delegation of authority to the superintendent designated to negotiate and to approve the contract and subsequent amendments with Drumall and Construction Company or subsequently ranked contractors for the elementary number 17 project. Number 7, award of CSP for special education equipment, supplies, and related services. Number 8, first option to extend CSP for HVAC, equipment, supplies, and related services. Number 9, first option to extend RFP for electrical services. Administration would recommend approval of these consent agenda items.
Number 4, grow your own grant.
Yeah. That is Ms. Steele, who presented earlier this evening. She's still here, or Mr. Chapa. We'd like to talk about how we're growing our own paraprofessionals that we're recognizing this evening.
Ms. Steele. Ms. Steele is continuing to work with the University of Houston and the University of Houston Clear Lake and Goody's Grants. And through these grants, we're being able to identify more of those paraprofessionals that want to be able to become teachers. And so we'll continue to work with those universities to continue to get funds and help those individuals become certified teachers.
And the grant provides some funding for tuition for those.
Tuition, and then also for materials and supplies.
Oh, okay.
And Mr. Sampson, I believe, was that how that PowerPoint was not? Okay, yeah, there you go. I knew I'd seen it somewhere else. I got kind of a bigger green folder right here.
Oh, okay.
It's pretty much the numbers and information they presented to us earlier.
Oh, okay. Okay.
So, yeah, gotcha. We had several grant winners and.
Oh, that was what we the grant winners. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay, so any other questions or comments on.
I have a question. Coach Martinez, I just want to make sure I read it right. $150,000 worth of socks?
Somewhere around there.
Maybe
a little more.
That's like a half supply for every kid from.
Since you brought it up.
Socks.
There are socks for students in the old school. Sir? All the socks were distributed.
So I love it. Great. That's awesome.
From high school down to elementary?
Yes, ma'am.
Awesome.
So, since y'all brought it up, what's the definition of an athletic sock?
Some of them are a little bit longer, more elasticity in there, it can last a little longer.
They literally were Nikes and Adidas and yeah. Under Armour. They were good quality socks, correct? Ooh. Am I correct? Yeah. I didn't go dig through them, I'm so sorry.
No, they were Nike, Under Armour.
Oh, cool.
Even the, just the new styles coming out of the Liga, those were in there.
Okay, so how 21 pallets?
37.
37 pallets.
Yes. A lot of people got served in this area throughout the district as well.
That's awesome. Thank you so much.
That was the one condition on Academy Sports and Outdoors. They were willing to make the donation as long as we took it off.
Is it time for I make a motion that we approve the consent agenda items?
I'll second.
I'm not through yet. Seven A, 1 through 9 as presented.
I have a motion by Mr. Klein and a second by Mr. Cotter. Was that you? Who was Mr. Cotter? Who seconded?
I seconded it halfway through, but
okay. If it doesn't count, I will recall. I'll accept that. I'll accept that. So I have a motion and a second on 7A, 1 through 9. Any other questions or comments at this time? None. All in favor, please raise your right hand. 7, 4, that would be 0 against, 0 abstaining. Motion passes. On action item 7A, consent agenda 1 through 9. Moving now to 7B, future board agenda items, board training, and board meetings.
I would like to see a report of resignations over the last 5 years in GCCISD, broken down by ethnicity, race, age, and gender.
For you, Mr. Chapa, Mr. Wyatt. Okay.
I don't know if it would be helpful, but maybe, I don't know if it would be too quick, but with our workshop coming up in 8 days, if we could have it then.
Have it by the workshop?
Yeah.
Is that something?
We'll see what we can do.
All right.
Thank you.
Well, just do what you can do actually a report that if you can by workshop date, which Ms. Garcia is at the 27th. So we have October 27th workshop with Dr. Cleveland.
Yeah.
All right, and also we were in the process, Mr. Bollinger, are you still out there? Mr. Bollinger was going to do, find some times, dates for us to do a workshop for the communications, social media. Do we have a potential date for that? From TASB. Okay, so he's setting that up with our communications department and TASB. Legal to go over communications and rights and responsibilities. That would be a future workshop as well. Any other requests for future agenda items? I do know that also the committee applications are currently underway for the community committee for naming of facilities. That I'm assuming will be reported to us by next board meeting, November.
Yes, ma'am.
All right, so at the November board meeting, we'll have an update on applications for the committee positions. Board training, we still have until the end of October to complete any online TASA TASB sections. If you have not watched and recorded any time on TASA TASB, you have until October 31, Halloween night. You can stay home and do some training. And then we have our next board meeting is November 2nd. Regular board meeting, 6:30 p.m. is our new time. And are we going to maybe hear again, or are we still under, so we'll be meeting here unless something changes between now and then. Any other future board trainings, board meetings, or agenda items on anyone's list? Nope. All right, at this time, we will move to close meeting. We will recess into closed session pursuant to the following sections of the Texas Open Meetings Act, Texas Government Code Section 551.071, 0.072, 073, 074, 075, 076, 0.082, 0.083, 0.084, and 0.087. No action will be taken while the board is in the closed meeting. The time is now 8:15 p.m. Monday, October 19th, 2020. Recess.
High School, Elsa Aguilera.
I'll move to approve.
Second.
I have a motion by Mrs. Guy and a second by Mr. Laredo. Any questions or comments? All in favor, please raise your right hand. It is 7-4, 0 against, 0 abstaining. Motion passes. And that brings us to agenda item number 8. Then Mr. Cotter makes a motion. I have a second by Mr. Laredo to adjourn. All in favor, please raise your right hand.
Mr. Kent is not up. You got close, didn't you? Yep.
October 19th, 2020.